What's up, people? This is DJ.
Hey, mi gente, this is Ish.
And this is season two of Pero Let Me Tell You. Salsa, salsa es caliente. Salsa es caliente. Caliente mi fuente, goza y baila mi gente.
She looks like somebody's idea of what an elderly Korean woman would look like.
Mm-hmm.
She does.
Well, you know.
Anyway.
Is that what happens when you go to the candy shop?
And lick the lollipop?
I don't want to lick that lollipop. Si me queda como lo Kim.
How many licks does it take to get to the center of the... Anyway, is this episode 51?
This is episode 51, yeah.
51, como canal 51 Telemundo.
Ah, well, I like their new logo.
What's it's not that new logo anymore, but it was newer.
They got rid of the T.
Okay, everyone, well, welcome to episode 51 of Pero Let Me Tell You.
Yes, thank you guys for joining us. And well, first and foremost, what I want to say is a big thank you to the Magic City Casino and Burger mm-hmm. Beast for including us in the events this past weekend.
Yes.
We had
yes.
so much fun.
We had a lot of fun and a lot of food.
I think I'm still full of sandwiches.
I was full with sandwiches for like 2 days after because, you know, I took a crate load of sandwiches home.
You look like you robbed a food truck.
I did. But we, you know, as we said in last week's episode and as we posted on our Instagram, we were the judges at the gate.
Best sandwich of Miami.
And we had, how many entries were there? Seven?
Seven.
Seven of the best sandwiches.
Full sandwiches. They weren't sandwiches.
And let's just say that, thank God, we had to pace ourselves. You know, they would give us a new sandwich every 20, 25 minutes because it was a lot of food. But we had a lot of fun. We were with Burger Beast. Yes. We were with Martha of Miami. And we were with
our new friend,
Andrew from
Night Owl Cookies.
Night Owl Cookies. Yeah. So we had a good time in the trailer, VIP. Yeah. Not going to complain.
No, no. Free drinks and air conditioning. Not a complaint.
Not a complaint, though.
No. And we had a really good time at the Mega Mix Beer Music Festival, too.
Oh, yes. Yes. As TKA. Promised, a shout out to 305, the Miami
MIA Beer Company.
MIA Beer Company.
Yep.
We met up with them. They were absolutely great. Yep.
They were the sponsor brewery of the event.
I bought one of their t-shirts.
You did.
So a big, big shout out to them. And for the record, I am not a beer drinker whatsoever, but they had this guayaba beer.
It's really good. Regresa a mí.
It's funny because really good. I kept telling Ish, I'm like, it smells like guayaba here. Like, what am I smelling guayaba?
Again,
everywhere?
In Miami, it could just be Miami.
Right. It could be the Miami mist.
Right.
You know,
right. Our Sereno is guava.
But there wasn't scented. Anything like, there wasn't like a batelito stand
no,
or anything
no,
like that. No. So I'm like, where is this guayaba scent coming from? And it's because the MIA beer company had a guayaba flavored beer. And I actually tried it and I went for second when yeah, I was trying. Really I went for seconds and thirds, which again, I'm not a beer drinker. Yeah. So, you know, our hats off to them for trying to do something that, you know, I know beer is like a very serious, you know,
but it's very serious.
It's fun, but it's serious in the sense that people that make beer take the craft very seriously.
Yes.
You know, they don't half-ass it. No. But it's good to see that they're doing something that is very, very Miami, because I don't think you'll find guayaba beer in Minneapolis.
No. You'll find Paisley beer.
Paisley beer, purple beer, yeah, but not, beer. Not guayaba
not
beer.
Guayaba
so
beer, no.
Our hats off to them.
Yeah. No, it was a lot of fun. And I mean, you know, again, I always say this all the time, but we're very grateful and we still can't believe that we get invited to all these cool things and
I know.
Get to hang out, you know, and
people
just
are like, oh my God, the Pero Let Me Tell You guys are like, us? Us? Little us?
Us? So. Like we look behind us, like must be somebody behind us. You
yeah,
know,
it's not. The other Pero Let Me Tell You guys. So. Anyway, Widow, moving into our hot topics of the week before we get to our awesome interview.
Yes, with Orlando Leyba. Some of you may have seen his comedy, and for those of you who haven't, what the hell is wrong with you? Super funny guy and really just a great interview. We had a really nice time just chatting with him. Like I was telling you earlier, I edited it down because we just kept talking.
Yeah.
We loved
he, talking
with him.
He's been on Jimmy Fallon. He was hilarious on Jimmy Fallon.
He has his own HBO special.
I mean, so the guy is really doing doing it right now, and we were lucky enough to have him on the show, and he was great. And like speaking to him, it was like speaking to an old friend. So
yeah, absolutely. You know who's not having a very lucky day though?
D making.
Jussie Smollett.
Ay, Dios mío. Empire. The Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah. Something is striking back.
So let's review the case a little bit.
Yeah. Yeah.
So what day was it that this happened? It was about
end of January, give or take.
So there's a report that, you know, he was a victim of a hate crime, both homophobic
and racist
today, and racist. And allegedly he was beat up pursuant to the pictures that were released. Mm-hmm. It does show some lacerations in the face. And he was covered with bleach. Mm-hmm. And there was a rope.
I mean,
but
either
then
way.
There was, they said it was a rope, right? But a rope and a noose are two different. They're the same thing, but different in the sense, like, if I were to say that you had a noose around your neck, it's because you had a noose around your neck. If you have a rope around your neck, I would report that you had a rope around your neck. I don't know. I find the technicality of it important. Okay. Even if the intention is the same, I find the technicality and the reporting of it important. But nonetheless, this came out, and everybody was outraged, including myself.
Yeah. Oh, and likewise. And he said that they yelled, you know, this is MAGA country.
This is MAGA country. And when this happened, he allegedly was on the phone with his manager, I believe. Mm-hmm. That is what the initial allegation states.
Right.
And, you know, people were outraged. Mm-hmm. I mean, we may be in a very divisive time right now politically, and there may be a lot of animosity, but it's not every day that you see an actual hate crime to this extent, especially somebody's on a public figure.
Yeah.
And somebody kind of inoffensive in a sense, because he's not...
Like, who really has an opinion on Jussie Smollett.
Right, he's one of these guys, he's very well-liked, and I mean, he's...
Flies under the radar mostly.
Yeah, and I wouldn't say he's somebody who's particularly controversial.
Right.
He is an activist, but again, he's not somebody who up to now has been particularly in the middle of any controversy. So again, those were all things that's kind of like, I mean, this can happen to anybody, obviously.
Right.
But you know, we're all things like, oh wow, I mean, this happened to this guy. Excuse me. And yeah, everybody was outraged. So early on, or a few days later, you know, the first kind of like, first kind of element of this that kind of made the news that people started to wonder was the fact that the police had asked him for his phone so they could retrieve the phone records.
Yeah.
And that's standard in any investigation. I mean, if you state in your allegations that you were on the phone when this happened,
they gotta check your records.
They're going to check your phone records.
Right.
And that's something that's very standard. They're going to check everything. And he refused to give initially his phone records. And that was like the first...
That
thing that kind of...
I found that very odd.
Honestly, even at that point,
I didn't believe that this was what it turned out to be, or could turn out to be.
You know, because let's be honest here. Maybe he had content on his phone that he didn't want to share. You know, whether it was...
Fair enough, but...
You know, whether it was personal pictures or personal texts. Maybe there was something in his phone he didn't want to share.
That was his... I don't want to say defense, but that was his explanation. I can understand it. I can sympathize, blah, 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 blah. You know, he didn't want the cops to have Taraji P. Henson's phone number or whatever. But if you're the victim of such a vicious attack, I would like to think that if that happened to me, knock on wood, that it doesn't, I would be like, what do you need?
Absolutely. But even at that point, when that came out, I didn't automatically think.
I didn't automatically think, but I did think you were so adamant, and now you're
right. I was thinking maybe, you know, from a legal perspective,
right,
I was
thinking
like,
this doesn't look,
give this.
Do it. Right.
Because the more you resist, the more it's going to look bad on you.
Right. Right.
So, I mean, that's just the way that I see it, but I didn't necessarily think it was what it's turned into. So then more investigations are done. There is no surveillance of the actual incident.
Right.
And
it's the one area where the cameras weren't working, I believe, right?
There's no surveillance of the actual incident. But there was surveillance of two men walking down the street around the time that this happened, and the men fit the description that he stated were the aggressors.
Mm-hmm.
So more investigation takes place. They identify the men, they arrest them, and they bring them in.
Well, they didn't arrest them, they brought them in.
They arrested them because they were fleeing the country.
Oh, I thought they brought them in and they didn't officially.
No,
they got charged and they dismissed the charges.
They arrested them. They brought them in. They questioned them, and then they were released, and no charges were pressed against them. Right. So, during the investigation of these two men and the testimony, then the police, the Chicago police, releases a statement stating that the focus of the, based on new evidence, the focus of the investigation has shifted, and now Jesse Smollett is no longer seen, considered a victim in this.
Well, they incident. And they wanted to speak with him again, which again is standard practice.
Right, but the most important key element in that statement that the Chicago police released was that this was no longer being investigated as him being the victim.
Right.
Which that's enormous because this started with an allegation that he was the victim of a hate crime. So the fact that he was no longer being considered a victim is, you know, quite important and relevant.
Kind of.
To the event. Kind of. And so there's a few back and forth. He says he's not going to further testify. So now it's been
Officially been charged.
Huh?
He's officially been charged with filing a false
statement. When was that today?
Literally just happened.
Okay, well, as hot off the press.
Hot off the press. I was looking at it. I was on
this EW. This is what happens when you're busy in the office all day. Which I generally do. So he's been officially charged?
Yeah. I'm just going to 1 second. I'm actually pulling it up here. Jesse Smollett officially charged with felony for filing a false police report.
Okay, well, there we go. So, what are we going to do about this? What do we think of this?
I have lots of questions. First and foremost is why? And I think that's the question on everybody's mind. I'm reserving benefit of the doubt here because I still want to believe that if somebody is making these types of allegations, they're not making it up, right? Like, I would hate for this to turn into the next time somebody is the victim of a hate crime. Oh, they're probably making it up like that Jussie Smollett guy.
Right. I mean, I think people are still believed. I mean, it doesn't change my opinion on people that make these type of reports.
Yours.
No, I mean, yeah, I know. I understand what you're saying. And I mean, look, there's always going to be skeptics to anything.
Absolutely.
You know? There's women who say they're raped, and there's people till this day that will be like, no, you weren't.
Yeah. No, fair enough. But to what end? Like, what was his end goal? If it turns out that all these stories are true, and he not only orchestrated it, but rehearsed it, put it all together. I mean, just to the magnitude that this has gone on, where he even had an interview where he's like crying and saying, this is true. I don't care if people don't believe me. To what end? What was his goal?
That's what I scratched my head in. What was your goal?
What were you going to gain from this?
Was it that you wanted to bring negative attention to people that support Donald Trump? Is it that you wanted to bring awareness into hate crimes? I mean,
there's so many other ways to do that.
I know, and obviously, I understand that. But I mean, exactly, what was it? You know, was he trying to show that as a celebrity, you know, he could still be
anybody could be
anybody can, even somebody like him was a celebrity? I have to tell you, the first thing of that case that I found weird, I did not think that it was fabricated based on this. But the first thing that I found weird was the bleach. Because I'm like, who walks the streets of downtown Chicago with a thing of
fair enough, of bleach? But okay, even that, and even the rope, right? Like, who's walking around with these things? But initially, he had allegedly, which now I'm calling that into question too, received a threatening letter. Mm-hmm. So maybe these were people who were following him. You know, they had already sent a letter to the Empire, you know, where they filmed Empire, the production. They knew he was in Chicago. Maybe, you know what I mean? Like, if you're, again, but why were they so dead set on him, right? Like, but okay, let's say you're really dead set on having this happen to a particular person. You could stalk them. And, you know, and
you could stalk them.
No, but like, you know,
that's an alternative.
No. But what I mean is stalk them to the point where, like, you know their schedule. And so you can plan ahead and have a bottle of bleach or whatever. I don't know, you know, but I will say this. And then putting it on record, it is February 20th, 9:40 p.m. He was just charged. I guarantee
it's Beto Friday.
I guarantee by Beto Friday, there will be a statement saying that he has entered some type of treatment facility.
You think so?
Oh, of course.
And then he's going to come out and say that this was a very dark time in his life.
Absolutely.
that
absolutely
he was suffering from emotional
mark
distress
my words.
And
mark my words, he's going to go into some type of treatment center because that's what always happens in these situations.
Right, and he needs some time to carefully think about his actions and what he's done,
exactly,
the place in his life. And then later, probably by the end of the year, he's going to sit down with, like,
I was going to say Robin Gibbons, Robin Roberts.
Again, since she's interviewed him a few times, saying he was in a very dark place in his time.
Yeah.
He was, you know, he was very depressed. He was coming to terms of who he was and what he was doing.
As a celebrity.
As a celebrity. And, you know, he was in a very, very, very dark place where he couldn't make decisions. You know that dark place Lady Gaga lives in?
Yes, the Gaga cave.
The Gaga cave. And that, as such, he made very bad decisions. But instead of recording a song with R. Kelly, he made it into right?
Again, another alternative if you're in Chicago.
It's just a damn shame because I actually like him very much. And I think he is mega talented.
Yeah.
And in Empire, I mean,
that shows. I mean, I haven't seen it in a season, but it's really good.
I mean, he's one of the best characters on that show.
Yeah.
And now there's talk that they're going to either, I don't know if they're going to fire him, but they're certainly going to cut his scenes for now.
Well, yeah.
So there's a chance that he's not even going to be on the show indefinitely or permanently
for the future, yeah.
And it's just a shame. I mean, he literally sabotaged his own career. And I mean, I just think that it's such a stupid move. Aside from the fact that being a flat out lie, it's just a stupid move because in this world today of like social media and security and surveillance and everything,
todo mundo se entera de todo.
Everybody knows where you're at.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody knows where you're at. So to corroborate something, it's not very easy to prove or disprove something,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And that he thought that he could fabricate this intricate story and that nobody would be the wiser. Maybe he thought, well, you know, nobody...
They'll never find the guys.
They'll never find the guys, and you know I'm in a celebrity, and they're not gonna, you know, they're just gonna focus on the victimization part of it.
Right.
I mean, who knows what he was thinking? Who knows what he was thinking? But it's a damn shame. It really, really is because I really like him, and I think that he, in doing this, he hurt not only himself, but he gave such ammunition to these Trumpers.
He hurt two communities.
He heard two community and two causes that, you know, have worked so hard mm-hmm. to move ahead, you know, and that it's been such a sacrifice and
struggle and
struggle for so many years to move ahead and to be
yeah.
heard. And now he just took the movement back, you know,
I don't know how many,
forward,
but
three
yeah.
steps back, you know,
yeah.
But he also,
wait, are you saying the perpetrator was actually MC Scat Cat?
He gave ammunition to these people
yeah.
because these people are now going to be like, see, everything they say about us is made up. And they're all these leftist liberals, you know,
yeah.
snowflakes, they're all liars and they make stuff up for their own agenda. And then it's like, there's no defense in this case.
Right. But it's sad because it doesn't become an isolated incident. Now you become emblematic
right.
of everyone who thinks slightly like you.
Yeah.
It's, I'm very interested to see where this goes. To see what happens, to see if I'm right about the treatment center.
You'll probably go to, what is it, the Promises Center in, like, Sedona?
In Malibu.
In Malibu or wherever.
You know what's weird? When I watch Hulu, many times I get served, like, rehab treatment commercials.
Oh, yeah? They know?
I'm like, what the hell are the cameras on, apparently?
They know.
They
so,
know everything.
Jesse Smollett, shame on you. If
yeah.
I mean, if this turns out to be
yeah.
true, shame on you. I mean, you let a lot of people, you let a lot of us down. A lot of people that were in your corner, you let them down immensely. And you know what? Everybody makes mistakes and everybody regrets things. And we all have
yeah,
bad judgment calls and do stupid things. But I mean, how did he really think he was going to get away with this? I mean,
well, you know why? Because apparently, I'm assuming he didn't have anybody to run this idea by, like Burberry.
Oh, which, you know, what we talk about like every week, how, you know,
right.
like, things get by. And
you didn't run this by anybody?
Mm-hmm.
So for listeners who don't know, recently,
moving to our next mini topic.
Recently, Burberry released a coat, and it's a coat that has, I guess, in place of like a scarf, where a scarf would be or what have you. It's a noose. There's no debating whether it's, a rope, to your point earlier.
I think that you don't get art.
I don't get art.
Nor European music videos, but go ahead.
It was from Japan.
Uh-huh. Okay. And now I'm ready to jump. Anyway, what were you saying?
I haven't got much time to waste. So, Burberry.
I can make it alone. I could just sing it. I can make it alone. I can make it alone. Are you ready to jump? Get ready to jump. Don't ever look back. Oh, baby. Yes, I'm ready to jump. Okay, so Burberry made the other
five. So Burberry took a nosedive.
Literally.
Literally. And again, it's literally, like, it's not even something that you can look at and be like, oh.
So this is kind of a continuation of what we talked about in episode 51.
It's not Katy Perry's shoe.
Okay. No, I saw it.
This is a noose. Like, again, nobody looked at this and said, is that a noose?
You know what? I'm starting to think with fashion. I'm not being facetious with this. I think I'm starting to believe with fashion that it has a little bit to do with what you said one time. And I think you kind of said it being cheeky, but I think you actually,
as I do,
but I think it actually is true. These designers sometimes are very temperamental people, and, like, you know, you don't argue with a designer, you don't question because he's the artist.
Like Karl Lagerfeld, who just passed away.
And it's his vision, you know? Right. So if somebody comes with a jacket with a noose around it, oh, the artiste.
Right.
That's wonderful. That's so innovative. That's so...
You're taking something tragic and making it fashion.
Je ne sais quoi.
Yeah.
I mean...
Haute couture.
Oh my God, yes. Oh yeah, wonderful. Yes, bravo, bravo. And people eat it up.
Right.
You know?
Anyway, bueno, tell us.
Let's move on to fun things. And let's introduce our guest.
Dale, let's introduce our guest.
Okay. Were you telling me to, or were you?
No, niño, acaba to introduce our guest. La gente está manejando, llegando al trabajo, and they still haven't heard the interview.
I can have them on suspense.
All I ever wanted, all I ever needed is here. In my arms.
Well, I don't know about that, but our guest, Orlando Leyba, again, as we mentioned earlier, super funny comedian, has his own HBO special. We should start petitioning for ours.
We should, right?
We should. At the very least, we should get one on Mega TV.
Y you know que la mega se pega.
Exactly. Oh, but here you go, guys. Without further ado, our interview with the really funny and super sweet Orlando Leyba. Welcome back, listeners. So, as promised, we have the insanely funny Orlando Leyba with us. You may have seen him on Jimmy Fallon, on HBO. He has his own HBO special.
Yeah.
We don't have an HBO special. They wouldn't even let me on Taxi Cab Confessions.
Oh, my God. Did you really try that?
Well, they told me I was too boring. Oh, well.
No, I used to watch that. I used to be like, let's see what these degenerates are gonna say today.
Bueno, Orlando, welcome to Pero Let Me
welcome,
Tell You.
Sir. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, man. It is an honor.
No, it's an honor to have you.
Yeah.
So for those people who are like completely living under a rock, tell us a little bit of, you know, who you are and what your background is, and you know, exactly where we could find you and what you do.
Yeah. Bring us up to speed.
Orlando Leyba, stand-up comedian, originally from Dominican Republic, born in Puerto Rico. Yeah, but I was born in Puerto Rico. My mom used to work there. Then she got deported, and they didn't do the whole, like, they separate us now, you know, oh, let's put them in a cage. No, they punted me right across the water, and they said, they told my mom, whenever he wants to come back, he's allowed, because he has the blue passport. But
I don't think I've ever heard of a Dominican being deported.
Well, from Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
From Puerto Rico. Oh, my mom was there with fake papers.
Oh, okay.
So that's still, it. She had fake papers, traveled over to Puerto Rico, and she smuggled me in her womb. And then
it's a good place to smuggle.
Yeah. She gave birth to me, so that made me a citizen. And then someone ratted her out. And they booted her out of the country and sent me right along with her. So I got to grow up at DR and do the whole no electricity, no running lights thing, which was always, I didn't know any better, but I guess it was rough. I didn't care. I had fun. I run around in my underwears. And then did a whole lot of traveling between Puerto Rico and New York because it was cheaper to pay to get me a plane ticket out of DR. than to pay the taxes to keep me in DR.
Oh.
Because they would charge U.S. citizens taxes to stay there. Then in order for me to leave, then I would have to pay this tax plus my plane ticket. So every time that, like, my time was up in the country and they had to, like, kind of reset the clock, they would just buy me a plane ticket and ship me off to New York or Puerto Rico.
Right. Right.
And I did that for a bunch of years. So the age, I would say, till the age of seven, when I moved to Miami, Florida, and life was fantastic then.
So you moved to Miami at seven.
So I'm a Miami boy.
At
7 years, yeah.
Well,
so I'm a Miami boy, like, all the way. Like, I lived in Miami Springs, went to Miami Springs Elementary, then I went to PSN Elementary, then I went to Miami Lakes Middle, then I got kicked out, and I went to JMN Opportunity over by Opa-locka Airport. Then
I went to American High School. Oh, he really is from Miami.
Yeah, then I went to American High School, got kicked out of there because I was running down the hallways with the ROTC rifles.
As one does.
Yeah, because I was chasing this kid with the rifle to hit him with it because him and me had this whole thing, bad spy, good spy thing. He dropped a garbage can on me from the second story of American High, in the a plastic one. Man, that caught me and knocked me out. Oh, man.
It you got so knocked out by fun, a plastic garbage can?
Yeah, the plastic garbage cans in the hallways, man.
Oh, yeah, the hard ones.
Dropped one on me from the in the atrium at American High School and hit me and knocked me out. And then when I came to a couple of days, it was like an everyday thing, me and this kid. I can't even remember his name, probably because of the garbage can hit to my head, but whatever. Anyway, so then I ended up in Miami Springs High School, graduated from there, and... that's my alma mater. I love it. Miami-Dade College now, because they're making it fancy, but it was just community college.
So this is, as we say in Cuban, un arroz con mango.
Yeah,
un arroz con mango, man. I try to teach that to L.A. people here. They're like, oh, what does that mean? I said, it's just not good.
Actually, if I've had arroz con mango, it's pretty tasty.
You have?
Yeah.
It's, I mean, if you like, mangoes are good.
Now it's probably carbs. An arroz con mango bowl, because everything's
listen,
a bowl
I'm not
going
to sit here and argue with your palate, so let's just leave it there, brother.
Okay, so you have
I'll tell you what. You know what I had yesterday? Crab. I went to the sushi restaurant. There must be a Cuban that works back there, because I had crab and salmon croquetas.
Together?
I was like, Jesus Christ. Who invented this? I told the server that. Who invented this? By the way, $10 for two. Kind of a ripoff. Anyway, keep it moving.
Did they call it a croquette?
Yeah, they called it a croquette.
Oh,
it was
no.
a croquette on the menu. Croquette. I was like, I gotta have this salmon and crab croquette.
Alright, so you're here in Miami, you know, Miami-Dade. Did you at that point know that you were wanting to be a comedian?
Wait, I gotta interrupt you for a second. Does your hat say Hialeah?
Yeah. 100%.
Awesome. Awesome.
Fantastic. Yeah,
because I grew up, part of my, when I went to Miami Springs Senior High School, I was living at 40 West 27. So I live right behind El Hipódromo, right there.
Oh my God. You lived in the epicenter.
Yeah. So I live right by, close to Palm Ave. But like when it was race season, man, shit, my apartment stunk, man. Because we were right by the, where they kept all the horses by the barns or whatever the heck.
Mira, eso es para que tú veas that even though he's been on HBO, Jimmy Fallon, living in L.A., you could take the boy out of Hialeah, but you can't take Hialeah out of the boy.
Nah, brother. No, you can't.
So, okay, so you're Miami-Dade, you know, doing your thing.
Yes.
When do you realize that you're either funny or that you want to be a comedian?
Well, like, in like school, I believe maybe in junior high, they named me, like, funniest kid.
Okay.
Me and this, I forgot her name. She'll kill me. Whatever. If she listens to you guys, she'll track me down on Facebook and cuss me out. So she was like, her and I got nominated funniest. So I always had a sense of humor because I can't fight for my life dependent on it. My brothers could fight. They were the goons. They were like the guys that could do that. I didn't. I got to color and write poetry. I was sensitive, you know, because I got protected by them.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So I remember being the funny kid. Then, you know, like all of us, we fall into the grown-up life. So then I bounced around in jobs. And then my last job, I was a satellite engineer for CBS News over at WFOR and The Route.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So okay. I worked for them. Yeah, I covered the launches. I covered Trayvon Martin. I covered hurricanes. I would chase hurricanes from the Keys.
Oh, shit. This up is the recent. Coast.
Yeah. So I did that. Photojournalist, too. I became there. An editor became there, too. That was my home. I still love those guys. But something along the way, just there was something that was always missing. And I was some way, somehow, always involved in entertainment. It attracted me. My buddies, they used to have a group, Sofla Kings. I used to hang out with them. Adrian Santalla, which is Drop, he used to record. He recorded like Lean Back with Fat Joe. So I used to be, he was the best man at my wedding. Pitbull, me and Pitbull knew each other like when Pitbull was just, making it. Yeah, when he was Armando. No, he was always Pitbull. I think I met Pitbull right after he took off his goals, because he used to have goals in his mouth. And he used to go to my buddy Jay's Napa Auto Parts to get parts when his car would break down. So we kind of like would pass each other. But once we were both, I used to hang out with these guys called the Sofla Kings, too. Mm-hmm. They were my buddy. I was like their manager. I didn't know nothing about managing. But somehow, someway. And then I ended up with this group called Dorks, Morons, Geeks. And they were a band. And they never had an opening act. So they used to have me go up and like warm up the crowd. And I, hey, guys. And put, you know, no one's showing up. It's only like 20 people in the club. We're at Oxygen downstairs at...
Oh, wow, in the Grove.
In the Grove. And I'm gathering people, and I would tell jokes, and people would kind of move close. By the way, you know, hindsight, right next to the improv, you know?
Right, that's true.
Yeah, and I didn't even think of it. And then that kind of fell through, and I remember I went up to New York with my wife, and we went to go see Kyle Grooms, which he now lives in Florida. And I saw him perform, and he also worked. Kyle Groom has been on the Chappelle Show and everything. Mm-hmm. He used to work at Univision, even though he doesn't speak Spanish, back in the day, before he did the Chappelle Show and became a full-time stand-up. Saw him. I got the bug. I walked out. I told my wife, I think I could. I want to try that. She was like, try it. It's your birthday. Next morning, I called from New York down to Miami Improv. I signed up for the first open mic. And I want to say... we're in 2019. I'm about to make my 9th year. That was 2010.
Wow. Wow. Congrats.
Yeah. So which really... is crazy. I'm a grown man. You get me? Like, I live right there. I don't live... I'm roads adjacent. Me and my wife have a house in roads adjacent. So right off of 12 and, like, Coral Way, you know, like... Not in the road, so we're not paying the roads type of prices. Uh-huh. So we have front yard, backyard, house... You know, dogs, the whole nine, and now here I go talking about, oh, let me follow my dream. And I dove in, head in first, man. I cashed in my 401k and moved to LA. Wow, after 3 years in Miami. 3 years in Miami.
Doing the comedy thing.
Cutting your teeth, kinda.
Right. Yeah. Making it happen, you know? But I calculated my age at the time, so, I want to say at the time I'm like 32 or when I started. Mm-hmm. So I was just like, nah, man, I got to make this happen, dude. I got to make this.
It's funny because 32 is not old, but to start such a drastic, you know, like you said, you were a grown up already.
Yeah,
you
know, I had a house and everything.
It's scary.
You know, my wife, we're making, you know, my wife is clearing over 100K. I'm like at 60, 70. You know, like we have a life, dude. No kids, thank God, but
that makes it easier, I guess. Yeah.
So I'll let you guys talk. Let me take a break.
So your first night in the open mic of you know, the improv here in Miami, and we you know, we've been to the improv here and we love it, and so we know exactly what you stepped into. How was it? You know, because a lot of times these success stories, like maybe the first night was a total fail. Did you, like, right away, did you completely win over the audience?
Yes. I had. What I said, I can't remember. I don't remember my jokes. I was just, I'm naturally funny, and I also have that, I likability.
Yeah.
Likability and being adorable. I come to entertain. I come to serve. So right. I operate, my whole life, it comes from a place of serving. Mm-hmm, so right. this weird thing where, you know, your creator, your the universe, God, whatever you want to name it, kind of takes care of you when you operate from a place of service, you know?
Right.
That's beautiful. So my whole life has always been that way.
Yeah. Well, I have to say, you know, you mentioned Adorable, so that is the name of your HBO special.
Yeah.
Having seen in that and, you know, your other acts, I mean, obviously when you're on network TV, you got to keep it, you know, PG, but I get the feeling that, you know, as you're not a quote-unquote, you know, raunchy comic, you're not really about, you know, cursing and just being vulgar for the sake of vulgarity. Was that a choice you made? Or is that just to kind of say what you were saying, like, that's just who you are. You know, you're just not that guy.
That's who I am. Obviously, for TV, you kind of clean it up more. But if you come to a live show, you're going to hear a fuck or a damn or right. or shit. Because I'm not telling jokes. Most of it is stories.
Right.
So I can't. I'm not going to tell you that when I slammed my hand on the car door, I said, darn it.
Right,
or,
right.
Oh, HE double hockey sticks. Man, this isn't growing pains. This is real life, you know? So it's like, it doesn't worry me or whatnot, because a lot of the comments I get, you're so clean. And it's like, yeah, you're only seeing me of a spurt of 15 minutes, 5 minutes around town. Mm-hmm. You know, older people usually talk to me like that. But then when I do long sets, even they, I know I cursed in it. I know I said stuff I wasn't. Because clean goes both ways. Like, I have that, I have a joke where I say, you guys are being rookies. I see you out here with your wives, and you're trying to get her in the right mood, but all I see you is giving her liquor. So you're not following the right recipe. It has to be liquor, liquor, water. Liquor, liquor, water. You can't just be liquor, 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 because you're not going to get the right one. When you get home, you're going to be like, hey, babe, come on, let's play, let's fool around. And she's going to be like, no, I don't want to fool around, because you gave her too much liquor. Right. And then she finally says, you want it so bad, here, take it, it's yours. Now you, as a man, are scared. You're like, no, I don't want it anymore. Last time you got like that, you scratched me, and you try to use a thumb on me. Oh. And people laugh, you know, so it has a little. But you understand, that joke, you can't say that on the Tonight Show or on cable late night shows. Maybe I could get away from that. But like a Tonight Show, and so, it's not proper. It's like, what, you know? They're going to question it.
Yeah.
So it's not. I'm not cursing. I'm not saying. But I'm dancing around a very blue area. Yeah.
As I say sometimes, you're being delightfully inappropriate. Which is you're not.
Oh, I love that.
You know, you're not outright saying
that.
Something,
that is
but
fantastic way of putting it.
Delightfully inappropriate.
Yeah.
Actually, delightfully inappropriate.
Speaking of delightful
t-shirts, that is beautiful t-shirt.
Speaking
delightfully
of delightful
inappropriate.
So I loved your set on Jimmy Fallon. I distinctly remember it a couple of months ago, and I was a big fan, and, you know, I went back and looked at a lot of your stuff online, so I have to say, your wife must be a very good sport.
Oh, she is, man, she is, she understands it. My wife used to be, a pageant and a singer, so she sang, like, on the Christina show.
Oh, wow.
She was going to be the opener for El Puma.
Like, oh, my
but
gosh.
But she's young.
That's
yeah,
awesome.
My wife was like a child type of prodigy, you can say. She modeled. She did all that. She was like Miss Columbia, whatever, in Miami. You know, so she understands the world. And she knows that I'm a sponge. So anything that happens, I'm going to probably talk about it. You know what I'm saying? So
I have
she
to
was
say-
there, and she was there. And the thing was, here's, like, you know, behind the curtain story. Jimmy Fallon, before we went on air, he says, this guy, I met him backstage. He gave me the most warm introduction before bringing me out, before the TV audience. This is for the audience on set in the studio. He's giving me such a – he's here. He's making his late night debut. His wife is here. You know, and the first thing I do is I come out and I'm like, I like missing my wife.
Yeah.
You know?
Exactly.
And I call this guy the Vince Lombardi of late night sets, which is a guy by the name of Michael Cox. You can look him up. He is the booker of the Tonight Show. Oh. He works with you. He helps you mold. He's not writing jokes for you, but he's like, hey, Orlando, that joke about a thumb up the ass, I don't think that's going to fly. He's that guy. He gives you the parameters, so you can play between here and here, right? So that guy and myself, we're both kind of worried. He knew, as being a guy who studies comedy and is in the comedy world, he knew that that was funny. But in today's climate, he didn't know if that was going to go over well. I like missing my wife. Actually, I love missing my wife. Como dice mi abuela, si Dios no me había derramado un don, if I hadn't had the blessing that my creator gave me, and I have this stupid, silly face that I look kind of like a bear and kind of like a like an idiot, you know, I wouldn't have been able to get away with it. If I would have been like a nice jawline, hey guys, welcome everybody, if I would have been that guy and said that line, I don't think that line would have
flew.
That's true.
So it flew. So it was
It's funny because in that set and in a few of your sets, you mentioned, which that's a part that, I mean, I was laughing in the entire set, but in particular when you talk about Chip and Joanna from the Magnolia line.
Yeah.
And it's funny because, like, I do feel that their show, for so many people, it's like addictive. It's like a lifestyle. And whenever I see now these guys, because they have like a line at Target.
Yeah.
And they have like a whole section of Target that's about them. Whenever I see like these men there with their wives, you know, looking at like, you know, a cashmere throw or like, you know, some
tomato. Listeners, he's holding up an HGTV mug.
I'm like, these guys, as he calls it, are evolved.
Yes. Yeah, clearly, it's not just for the skin.
So, another story. So, that same week or the following week, you'll see that Joanna and Chip went on the show. I get a text from one of the producers on the show telling me, I'm in the hallway right now watching Chip Gaines repeat your jokes back to Jimmy Fallon. And they're telling me this is happening. I go, are you serious? And they were like, because right away, a lot of people embraced me there. Man, I got to tell you guys, one of the best experiences of my life. That whole show is set up for you to succeed. So the Tonight Show, they came and they set up the whole night for you to succeed. That's what it is.
That's awesome.
Everything about the show is for you to succeed. Everybody's there. I feel that's the type of place that if you're having a bad day and you work there, they send you home. They're like, don't worry, we're going to pay you. Just go home. Your vibe is off.
I really like Jimmy Fallon. I feel that Jimmy Fallon, I mean, you've met him. I haven't. He seems to be the type of person in real life that he shows to the world. He seems to be like a really nice, nurturing guy.
I have friends who work there, and I also have people who used to work there. Like, for example, my agent, Katie Edwards, she works at APA now. She used to be a page for The Tonight Show.
Oh, wow.
So it's like she's the lowest of the lowest in the totem pole of employees.
Right.
And she got treated top notch in everything. You know, they treated her well. She has nothing bad to say about The Tonight Show. And she's been around me like that. We've been drinking. And I'm like, Katie, nothing. So when I went there, that's what I received. And like I said, he wasn't supposed to come into the green room. He came in twice. And each time it was like for 15 minutes, just going back and forth and talking. And we're talking about comedy, and we're talking about him being a Just for Laughs, and we're talking about being a Friar, which is this club just for stand-up comics up in New York, and he's a member, and I want to be a member, but need to get co-signed by like three other Friars, you know. And he was just honored that I knew all that stuff, that I wasn't just, you know what I'm saying, I'm not just a guy that came out of college and just from college went into stand-up. I kind of, Sebastian Maniscalco, I remember one time I was going to hang it up. I was still in Florida. I'm 2 years in. I started working with Sebastian Maniscalco. If you don't know Sebastian Maniscalco, look him up. He just sold out Madison Square Garden four nights. Oh, my gosh. Wow. You know, he did two nights at Madison Square Garden, four shows total. Sold them all out. That's like 18,000 people each show. Crazy. And Sebastian Maniscalco, I asked him, I said, man, I feel like I got into this too late. He goes, nah, man, you have experience. You've lived. You're a man. You're grown. You're not just some guy who came out of college and is like, blah, 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 just figuring it out, you know? Like, right. You actually figured out life to a certain degree. Now you can talk on it, and people will listen, and they'll be original.
Well, know? Yeah, I mean, like, for example, that's in that true. Same skit of in Jimmy Fallon, everything you talked about in that show, I feel, are things that most people, are everyday things that most people can relate to, that we probably don't even give too much thought in, but then when you mentioned it, especially in such a humorous way about, like when you're watching what's the one where they pick the house hunters, it's true, you get like really yeah. involved, and I'm the like, first one that I'm like, pick the craftsman, you know, four bedroom, and I'm like, why do I even care, like
why do we care, you know what I'm saying? Why there's are we another so joke this? To that, which is like that's the only time that I can really beat my wife and celebrate. When I pick the right house, I beat her and I'm like, yeah, I told you they were going to pick the finished basement. I told you.
That was right. So let's talk a little bit about Netflix. I mean, that's huge.
HBO,
I'm sorry. That's huge in like the you know, stand-up world. How did that happen?
Just a grind, man. Just a grind. Again, I'll bring up his name again. Michael Cox over at The Tonight Show. He gave me one of the best compliments, low-key compliments online. When I did The Tonight Show, when I was making my debut at The Tonight Show, he decided to post up, and this is what he posted on his Facebook, which, you know, other entertainment people, behind-the-scenes people, are reading his post. Right. And on his post, again, Michael Cox, the Vince Lombardi of Tonight Shows, he tells me, he wrote on his post, Orlando Leyba, finalist at Big Sky Comedy Festival, finalist at Laughing Skull Comedy Festival, finalist at Stand Up for Diversity. And tonight he's making his late night debut. That meant so much for me. And that was his way of letting the industry know, this kid didn't just come out of anywhere. He's mm-hmm. been out there for the last 3 years grinding.
Right.
Making it, meeting people. To me, it hasn't been grinding. I've just been doing the work. I don't have a job. I get to put in the work because the work is the purpose. So my purpose is to serve you guys and make you guys laugh. That's my genuine purpose inside. So once you know your purpose, now you do the work.
That's
I don't have. I just do the work.
It really is. So something I've always been really curious about comedians, especially you, since you talk so much about like your wife and your life, you know, are you just sitting there sometimes and something happens and you're like, wow, this, I got to write this down. I got to
file it away, put mental this note in my or act. Something.
Yeah. Do you keep notes on that or just, you know, does it come spontaneous?
But it just triggers. There's certain things that trigger in my brain and then it files away.
Right.
And then I'm like, oh, that'll be cool. And then, like, sometimes it happens, and I just keep it moving. I just keep moving.
Right.
I just keep moving, man. But there's something that jumps back there, you know, and stays there. Like, I have a bit about going into, it was The Gap, and I asked for a pair of jeans, and I didn't want to even try on the jeans. And that's what I was like, oh, they'll be nice. Go get those jeans. And I'm like, those jeans are ripped. I don't believe in wearing ripped jeans. I've already been poor. I don't need to keep on pretending. Like, we got a little bit of money. I don't need to pretend I'm poor anymore. I've already worn jeans like that in real life in Dominican Republic. I don't, you know. And my mom would sew them back up, so it wasn't even like they lasted that long. Yep. You know, she would put a patch on them and keep it moving. And she goes, try on the jeans. And then I say, well, I'll listen to her now, so I don't have to listen to her later.
Right.
Pick so I go inside and I try on the jeans. Right. But when I go inside, I ask the sales kid, hey, buddy, do you have my size in those jeans? He goes, oh, no, we don't have that size. Like, he said it kind of loud, and right. something happened inside of me. Like, it started bothering me. So then I go, okay, I get it. You ran out of my size. And I start making my way out of the store. He tells me, oh, no, we never have that size. And I was like, this is an outrage. And I went with my finger. So that automatically started writing itself.
Right.
That made the, and I just turned it up. So then I talk about how I just turned into an 87 Jewish guy on stage when I start sprinkling the comedy. And I yelled at him in the store, but not at him. I just said, this is an outrage, because I felt like everybody looked at me and they were like, who's this Fatty McFat that can't fit into the jeans, you know? And he didn't have to put it that way. So, and then I start exaggerating, and I talk about how I yell at him, and I said, I'm writing an email, and I drive to a public library. I could have wrote the email on my phone, but I felt like I needed the whole computer, because you need to feel my anger. You're going to feel my anger on this keyboard, right?
That keyboard is going to get it.
Yeah, and like a month later, I get a coupon for a free pair of jeans, and then I say, yeah, I still can't wear the jeans, but whatever, a win is a win, a win is a win. So that whole thing just amplifies, and now I chunk that and I put that under the subject. That's under the subject of me. I'm getting older and I'm getting petty. Like, I'm petty. So now. And then people say, oh, petty's a bad thing. But I'm like, no, I'm petty with a purpose. Like, now I write bad Yelp reviews. I never did that before. Mm-hmm. Something what didn't taste good, I just didn't eat there. And I'm like, now I write. Like, yo, the pasta was fucking cold. What are you talking about, dog? So I'll complain on a restaurant. I'm an internet snitch, man. I become an internet snitch.
Is that also because you've evolved?
Yeah, because I've evolved. Oh, you should see me. I have unfriend Tuesdays. Like, friends that post up stuff I don't like, uh-huh. I unfriend them like that. I low-key report people, too. I'm that guy. I report people. I don't care, man.
I do like petty with a purpose, though.
And my buddy said... What was that?
I do like when you said you're petty with a purpose.
Yeah, I am petty with a purpose. Look, like, I called Apple, right? Because customer service, because they did an upgrade to my phone. They snuck into my house in the middle of the night, like freaking burglars, right? And upgrade my phone without asking me. They upgrade my phone. I try to go to the gym. My music doesn't play anymore. It's scratching. Oh. Mm-hmm. It's scratching. It's like, like a scratch CD or a scratch record. I call Apple and I say, hey, guys, you guys did this update. And now my music is scratching. They tell me, oh, yes, Mr. Leyba, we've been receiving calls about the that particular glitch in our system. Here's what you need to do. You need to delete your musical application, reinstall your musical application, and download all your music again back from the cloud. Can you do that? And I answered her, hey, you lost me at what you need to do. And I hung up the phone because I don't work for Apple. You get me? They don't pay my life insurance, bro. They don't pay my health insurance. I don't wear a genius shirt. I'm the furthest thing from a genius. Just create another upgrade that fixes your last upgrade.
Don't if you're have such me a go genius.
Yeah. And here it is. Yo, listen. They did that. That's exactly in the following upgrade, they fixed my musical glitch situation.
And it's all because of Orlando. It is. Yeah, they won't say it, but it is.
Petty with a purpose.
Petty with a purpose.
I am petty with a purpose. I am petty for all of us. Yeah. I'm not just petty for me. I am a society petty contributor.
On behalf of society, I thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Oh, yeah. I have to tell you that in a few of your pictures, when you let your hair down, and I mean this as a compliment, you look like The Weeknd.
I look like The Weeknd, yeah. But that was a few days. Now I just look like one of the purple minions. Have you seen the? Yo, my wife burned me with that. I just get out of nowhere just a random picture, and it's a picture of me with my hair out, and then a side by side with one of the purple minions. And I was like, holy crap! I look like a purple minion. That was pretty cool.
Anyway, back to our interview mode. Oh, God. Yeah, no. So where do you see yourself in 5 years?
No, really. That's not a job interview.
What's down the line? What's coming up?
Just comedy, man. I just want to stay in this lane, and everything else that I've received has been from the comedy. So I've already done the Tonight Show. I got a 30-minute HBO special. Mm-hmm. I did an animated film called Lewis and the Aliens. That already came out. It went straight to DirecTV. That have kids are like, yo, is that you? It is you. I just saw you in the credits. My kid is watching your movie. I was like, well, it's not my movie. I'm just a character in the movie. I'm one of the main characters because I play an alien called Wobble. It's called Lewis and the Aliens, the movie. So all that just came from the stand-up. So here's my theory, guys. If I just stick it out with this stand-up, I might win an Oscar, man.
Oh, why not?
You never know. Listen. You never know. I'm not saying I'm aiming for that because that sounds like a lot of work. And I do suffer from lazy tendencies. But listen, just maybe. Maybe something magical like that will happen, man.
So are you on tour now, or...?
Yeah, just tour. If you just go to heylando.com and you check tour, you see all my dates and whatnot.
Okay, we got to see him when he's in town.
I was going to say, are you coming down to Miami?
Yeah, I'm coming to Miami, and I'm excited about it. I still haven't had the date, and it's like the Miami Improv is home. And what's amazing that even though they closed it down and they opened a new one in Doral, my peace, my crew is still there. The two general managers are Melissa and Justin, and they came back to open that one. It's like, even though it's at a different location, it's there. But in Miami, you guys have great comedians. They just had Nary Signs. Ramon Garcia.
He's a friend of the podcast.
Actually, yeah, we know Nary and his wife. Yeah.
They're part of our network.
Yeah, Vanessa, we're part of the Geek Bro Network.
Yeah. So Nary Science, he was like, when we used to do a thing called Brown Rice Comedy because it's good for you, and at the Miami Improv, right? And Nary was always there, Ramon Garcia was always there, and myself was always there. So those are like my crew. And then a bunch of us got on airplanes and moved to L.A. So the first one, Miami guy that moved to L.A. was Dave Williamson. Then Forrest Shaw came out here. Then John Wynn and myself came out here. Al Jackson, which he's from out of town, but he started doing comedy there. Mm-hmm. My brother Ricky Cruz, he's still in Miami. He's doing a show at the Improv. I think it's called At Midnight or something like that. Mm-hmm. It's like a late night dirty show at the Miami Improv. So you guys look it up. And those are all amazing comics, man, that I've been blessed to be around. I might come in as a feature with Michael Yo, because that's like my brother. But we are working on like one whole weekend, you know, Thursday through Saturday at the Miami Improv.
That's awesome. You know? This is home.
I'm excited. I'll do press like crazy. It'll be like a great homecoming, you know. So my whole family's there, you know.
You're the only one who left Miami? Your whole family's still here?
Yeah, the whole family's still there, man. My wife's side of the family, my side of the family. Everybody's there, man.
So I'm curious, now that you know you're a Miamian living in L.A., I know that they say a lot of times that L.A. and Miami are kind of sister cities. What can you say about that?
They're not sister city. L.A. is very cold in the beginning. Mm-hmm. You got to find your vibe. You got to find a good troop. Miami is more welcoming. There's more things. But understand, everybody's here is about their business. Yeah. They're trying to break in. So it's hard to build a community here of friends. It's taken me 5 years, and I got a decent community. Mind you, that inner circle is all Miami people.
Oh,
you
know? All in LA. Miami people.
And we are a gang. Like, I have new Miami friends who like that I never knew in Miami, but as soon as they know that I'm a Miami guy, we're good.
Yeah.
And we come together. Because we do march to a different beat. I'm Dominican, but I grew up around Cuban. The Cuban in LA, completely different than the Cuban in Miami. Yeah. Cuban in LA, very low key, very soft-spoken. Very
a soft-spoken Cuban? I don't know what that is.
Yeah. Very soft-spoken, very like, it's a different vibe. But it becomes that whole, I understand, like, going to Washington Heights and being Dominican in Washington Heights is the equivalent of being Cuban in Miami. Is that true. Rowdiness. There's so many of us that we have to talk loud to overpower
the other. Nobody will hear each other.
Yeah. But here's the thing. I end up moving to this part of town in L.A., this beautiful city called Glendale. It's right next to Hollywood. It's great. I love it because it's real people here. Everybody, you know, my next door neighbor has his own mechanic shop. He goes, it's like regular blue collar people live in Glendale, along with a few entertainers. But Glendale, the majority is Armenians. They're Armenians.
Oh.
Armenians are the Cubans of Los Angeles.
That's Armenian. Awesome.
They're rowdy. That most of them drive BMWs. They wear jewelry. You know what I'm saying?
That's the best part. That's the accurate part.
Yo, no, listen, there's two BMW dealerships and three used BMW dealerships here by different owners.
Oh, it's not like a franchise.
No, they have a major franchise that is just like Bremen on Biscayne, which is huge. Two stories, everything is the number one car sold in this thing. Crime is low. There's no crime in my city. There's hella credit card fraud though. And you know what I'm saying? And they have their own businesses and everything. So I remember I said, man, Armenians are the Cubans of LA.
You had me a BMW. That's what I say about in Miami. Here is like everybody here drives a BMW and lives in inefficiency.
Yeah. No, here is more like they have houses, but everybody lives. They have the same culture, a Latino culture. They don't care that abuela lives in the house, and they don't care that they're 30 and they still sleep in the same bedroom that they did as a kid. It's pretty dope. Like the family thing. They look out for me, man. I never had. I've come home 3 a.m. Y hay una abuela from Armenia outside looking over the streets, yo.
Wow.
Yeah.
Ready to call the cops if anything happened. There's a little old lady or an old man smoking a cigarette, and they nod their head at me because I'm one of their kids now, man. They see me coming, oh, that's Orlando. He's the funny one.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? When I first got here, I was suspect to them, but now they trust me. You know what I'm saying? I'm cool, man.
You're one of them.
That's awesome. Who knew Armenians? Cubans.
Who knew?
Yeah.
Bueno.
And they're the same thing, dude. They're doctors, they're lawyers, they're judges, they're hustlers.
Yeah.
Some of them own beeper shops. I don't know who's getting beepers.
Using the same codes.
I'm not going to question it. You know, I also went into a pizza shop the other day. They looked at me like I was an alien. I was like, yo, what's up? Hey, can I get a pizza? Because it was just a random mom and pop pizza store. And he looked like, nah, dude. I was like, you guys aren't really a pizza shop, right? I told him to that thing. And they were like, no, we make pizza. And I was like, nah. He pulled out the pizza, and it was these little personal pizzas, like Ray's pizzas, but tiny. That looked like it, bro. He was making the journals, bro. He was. It was kind of like, yo, let me make this. Let's have this in the fridge just in case.
Por si acaso.
I was just like, nah, I'm okay. Sorry to bother your enterprise. I don't know what you're going here.
And I don't want to know.
This is clearly a laundry, and I'm not talking about clothes. And I kept it moving, bro.
I kept it moving.
I don't.
Bueno, Orlando, this has been a blast. Oh, we can't thank you enough for being on our show. I love it that you're from, not only that you're from Miami, but you really went out there and pursued your dream. Yeah. And, you know,
yeah.
you weren't 18. It. You were a man, como they say, ya with responsibilities. Entry that age, yeah. And yeah, you yeah, went
with
for
a 401k,
it.
Bro.
With a 401k, yeah.
But let's all, bringing it all together, they all those jobs had one something in common. They were all jobs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jobs. They weren't a purpose. They weren't what I really wanted to do that I didn't even know. But somewhere along the line, something decided to open up for me and showed me, this is the work. This is what you're supposed to do.
That's okay? Awesome.
And man, it doesn't matter how old you are. It really doesn't. I heard this dude, this Kentucky Fried Chicken dude, Colonel Sanders, whatever his name is, he started after he had retired.
Oh,
he was
yeah.
already retired, and then he started Kentucky Fried Chicken. It's never too late, man. If you just stay focused and think about what you want to do. And the main thing is to stay focused on what you want to do. Like, if you guys want to have the best podcast ever, I swear on everything that I hold dearly, all the answers will start coming to you.
So, I mean, that's a great way to yeah. end. And, yeah.
and you've definitely got a purpose, my friend.
Yeah. And we're proud of you. You're from Miami.
Yeah, no, man. Guys, I can't even thank you because this is... I can't tell you how sweet this is just to be able to, like, I'm talking to my boys.
I win, Orlando. We could be talking all night. Thank you so much
thank
for being
you,
on our
yes.
show.
Appreciate thank you taking time.
So, and thank please let us know when you're in town.
Absolutely.
I will. Just check me out. All social medias, Hey Lando. Hey Lando, heylando.com, at Hey Lando on social media. You guys got some great Miami comics. Make sure you go out there and support them.
Absolutely.
Ricky Cruz, I think he has a show coming up at the Improv. It's like a midnight show where it gets real dirty and real nasty. It's all about cursing and sex. It's so awesome. And Nery Signs, he's one of the OGs there. He yeah. knows, yeah. You know, he has the, what's up, what is it? Woo Bro.
Well, it's Geek Bro Network of the podcast. He's got Woo Bro. He's got yeah. Mount Geekmore. He's got a bunch of them.
Just support the local talent.
Absolutely.
Let me tell you something. is fucking amazing. What a great name that is.
Thank okay. you. It's very Miami.
Yeah, I know. It's right up there with Deja la Guaperia. No que trabaja en Burger King.
Deja la Guaperia. Ay, ay, ay. Bueno, Orlando, thanks a lot.
All right, brother. Have a great day.
All right, brother. Thank you, man. Thank you for having me again, bro.
Thank you.
Welcome back, everyone. Welcome back. Well, we already did the Welcome Back Cotters thing, jingle in episode, our first episode of season two. But anyway, bueno, welcome back. Bienvenidos. Wasn't that a fun interview?
That was a great interview, especially when you started talking about how, like, that's what he was, you know, he's here to provide that service. Like,
that service,
people
yeah.
laugh, and now we all have, like, that purpose.
I mean, yeah, it's, I love it when...
No offense, Orlando, but I don't expect comedians to be deep.
No, actually, that's what I was about to say when, you know, we think... I don't know why we often think comedians as maybe one-dimensional.
Right.
And you know, we often as an audience sometimes forget that they're obviously very multi-dimensional people, yeah. more than
most. Of them are
very dark. Yeah. And it's just great to see, like, you know, who he is and where he came from and how that affects his comedy and his routine. So
it's good to see a Miami boy do good.
Absolutely. So it was really a pleasure to have him on. So I'm thirsty.
Tengo una sed del carajo.
Del carajo. Do you know what a carajo means?
Yeah, it's the crow's nest.
Yes, on the boat. That's why they say, vete pa'l carajo. Anyway, it's soda time, people. It's the last Coca-Cola del desierto, and here yes, we go. So, my last Coke of the desert goes to the Academy Awards.
Like, as an entity?
As an entity, the Oscars, whatever. And this is both a good soda and a bad soda. But let me tell you something.
Okay.
Este año... The Academy Awards ha sido un desastre, and it hasn't even happened. First, they have the hosting debacle with Kevin.
Again, they could have called us.
I know, right? Can you imagine?
Do you know how many people they would have had to go through before they got to us?
Mira, instead of, you know, when Justin Timberlake opened up with Can't Stop the Feeling, we'll start with the theme of Que Pasa USA. And then we'll go, oe, oe. Of course, she'll make an appearance. You know, she is an Academy Award nominated musician
right,
for Music of Mother Heart. And your love is the music of... Why are we in such a singing mood today? Anyway, so it goes to the Academy Award. First of all, they had the Kevin Hart debacle.
Right.
Which I thought they handled poorly because if he didn't want to do it... First of all, we already talked about that here, so everybody knows what we think about. And so if he wasn't going to host it, then just pick another damn host. I mean, how hard can that be? I'm sure there's a lot of people who wanted to host the Academy Awards.
Rita Ora springs to mind.
Rita Ora will do it. You know, just pick another damn host. Then they had that awful, that I remember when it came out, you and I did the eye roll. The Academy Award in popular film goes to The Avengers. Iron Man 22. You know, Batman Infinity. You know, whatever. I'm making shit up at this point. So then they got rid of that category because that was a disaster. And then now the last, you know, mojon was that they said that there was four awards they were not going to put on air they're going to do during the commercials. So you've now taken the legitimacy out of those awards and the importance.
Wasn't it one of them for like cinematography?
Yes. It's not even like they were yes. Awards. Yes. So it's like I feel that they didn't. I mean, not everything that could have gone wrong. I mean, there's more that could go wrong. But it's like, metieron la pata over and over again. So, the Academy Awards, you know, you need a Coke to refresh yourself. That's so,
true. Back that truck up.
Here's the Coke, you know, the last Coke in the desert goes to you.
And I think they're the official sponsor.
So. They are? I think they're the official sponsor. It'll be interesting. You know what? They should open up these Academy Awards with the same musical number that they opened up the 1989 Academy Awards, which was the last time that they didn't have a host. And it was so horrifically awful.
Debbie Allen? No. With Snow White and Rob Lowe?
Yes, and Rob Lowe. Okay. Have you seen it? It's horrific. It's terrible. But it's actually wonderful at the same time. So maybe they should just recreate that. Just do it. 2019.
Just do it. Instead of, you know, Snow White, it could be Moana.
Uh-huh. Moana.
And The Rock.
Uh-huh. The Rock will do it.
The Rock will do it. He's the game. Yeah.
So.
Okay, so my last soda...
Goes to the Heifer Corporation.
My last soda has absolutely... You're never going to... Okay, I'm just going to jump in. And now this stupid site went down. So my last soda goes to a gentleman by the name of Kenneth Conan.
Okay.
Now, when Kenneth Conan was 18, don't laugh at this.
He saved the heifer?
No. When he was 18, he was involved in a horrible... cheerleading accident that left him paralyzed essentially from the biceps down.
Okay, why on earth would I laugh at that?
I don't know, because sometimes you laugh at things that are like, if I were to say like a cheerleading accident,
I would never laugh at that.
Okay.
You would laugh at that.
I would.
So, I'm so offended that you think I would laugh at that. Okay, continue.
All right. So I stumbled upon Kenneth's story and the reason that I'm giving him the last soda when I was actually looking at an article on out.com. about Jesse Smollett. And you know, you scroll down and sometimes it's like related articles or, you know, new articles or whatever.
Uh-huh.
I clicked on it because apparently Kenneth Conan, despite being a quadriplegic, his dream had always been to be in an adult movie. And he has now achieved that goal.
He did porn?
He did a porn. He can't move. He's in his chair. And he had always wanted to do gay adult porn, and he has now lived his dream. Listen, if you could see the look on DJ's face right now.
Well, everybody, thank you for listening to episode 51 of Pero Let Me Tell You. We hope you have a wonderful week, Pero Friday.
No, but hey, listen, you know what? That just goes to show you, everybody.
Okay, and here I was thinking, that you were going to say that he opened up like a cheerleading camp for quadriplegic children who wanted to be cheerleaders, and he was giving them a chance, and that's honestly the route that I thought this was taking, but the dude wanted to do porn.
He wanted to do porn, and he has now done one. So I put him out there as having the last soda because it just goes to show that just because you may have certain limitations in your life, you should never let that stop you from going after your dream.
And doing porn.
Listen, you have to be body positive, right? You know, just because you have a disability doesn't mean you are disabled.
I totally agree with that. I just did not know that. I didn't expect that this was the way the story was going to go.
Unfold.
So, Kenneth McKernan.
Kenneth Conan.
This Coke is for you.
This soda is for you, sir.
On that note,
it's not easy to make him speechless, ladies and gentlemen.
On that note, we hope you listened, laughed, and learned.
Well, I definitely learned that a quadriplegic can be born.
And grab your pastelito and your croqueta and your jupiña, and we'll see you next week for episode 52 of Pero Let Me Tell You.
Yes, we will. Bye.
Bye-bye.